हेलो गाइस, गुड इवनिंग गाइस। आई एम डॉक्टर रम्या हियर। So today I'll be discussing some of the very important image-based questions. So is my voice and audio, video, everything audible? I'll be discussing some of the very important image-based questions. Right. So I think my audio and video is visible now. So I'll start with the first question. But I just want you, if everything is all right, you can message me in the chat so that it's all right and everything is being seen. Hi, Bhavsar, Mulai, Navarun, good evening, Sanket, Manibala. Right. I think now it's perfect. So we'll start with the first question. So HSG is showing the following condition. All of the following symptoms can be seen with this except. So first we have to identify what is this image and what are the symptoms with which it can be presenting to you, right? So can you tell me what is this image? What is this image telling us? This is a HSG image, right? So this hysterosalpingography, what is this image? How do you describe this? So this HSG image is described as honeycomb appearance. So I will tell you this is called as honeycomb appearance. So any guesses, where do you see this honeycomb appearance? Yes, Laya, Bhavsar. So I see answer as A, that's fine. But can you tell me what is this, in which condition do we have this honeycomb appearance? So we mainly see this in Asherman syndrome. We mainly seen this in Asherman syndrome. So this honeycomb appearance, so you will see multiple filling defects. So you can see there is a dye going here, but some places the dye is not able to reach. And the where dye is not able to reach, there you will see black color. So this is honeycomb appearance because of the, yes, very good, excellent, Navarun. It is the Asherman syndrome, right? So all of the following symptoms can be seen with the Asherman syndrome except red. Yes, Bhav sir. So it is Asherman. So all of the symptoms can be seen with that except. So now can you answer it? It's not A. Good evening, Jyoti. So hypomenorrhea, yes, there'll be decreased bleeding with Asherman's, right? So there can there also be amenorrhea. That is no as the fibrosis increases and there'll be complete adhesion of the anterior and posterior wall, you will completely have absence of bleeding. So they can have amenorrhea. And yes, they present to you with infertility also. Now, I have seen many students getting confused between hypomenorrhea and oligomenorrhea. Asherman syndrome will cause hypomenorrhea, that is decreased bleeding, but not oligomenorrhea. Whereas oligomenorrhea is what? Less than 24 days. According to FIGO, it is less than 24 day cycle, right? So it will cause hypomenorrhea, amenorrhea and infertility, but not oligomenorrhea. So answer is D. Infertility, it 100% causes. Asherman syndrome presents to you with infertility, okay? Actually, to be frank, when they have tuberculosis causing Asherman, 70% of them come to us with infertility, right? So the answer here is yes, very good, Navarun. The cycle duration will be same. It doesn't decrease. So they initially they might have hypomenorrhea or amenorrhea, but not oligomenorrhea. Okay, later when it is amenorrhea, then obviously then it is different story. So let's see the next image now. 28-year-old, this was AIIMS question. 28-year-old patient presented with infertility since 3 years. Both partners investigated. Male partner semen analysis normal, normal USG pelvis and HSG. Laparoscopy done reveals this. What is the management? So in the image, what are you seeing? What is this? Very good, Dinesh. So this is a picture of PCOS. Very good, excellent. So this is PCOS. So whenever we see white colored ovaries, this is also called as oyster shell ovaries, because normally ovaries will be pink color, but here you are seeing their white color. So this is oyster shell appearance. So they presented 28-year-old. Now here key points are 28-year-old and they're having infertility since 3 years. And it is showing oyster shell ovaries, right? So what should be the management? C, I see C, okay. So yes, very good, excellent, Jyoti and Nabarun. Yes, so it is, you cannot go with weight loss and diet management here because they have been infertile already for 3 years. So I have to take certain action here. So that's why it won't be weight loss. Now it can't be laparoscopic ovarian drilling. So laparoscopic ovarian drilling also it can't be, because laparoscopic ovarian drilling is done when your medical management fails, or then they cannot have the they cannot come to you for follow up. Those are the conditions where we go for laparoscopic ovarian drilling. So this cannot be. Oh, very good. Hi, Paritosh. Right. So ovulation induction with letrozole. Yes, that's correct. Ovulation induction with letrozole is correct. Ovulation induction with clomiphene citrate is again wrong, because the first line drug now for PCOS is letrozole. The first line drug for PCOS is now letrozole. So that's why the answer is C, ovulation induction with letrozole, right? So this image was given as an image based question. So this, whenever you see any white ovaries, it's nothing but your PCOD. Yes, the dose of letrozole is 2.5 milligrams to 5 milligrams. So we initially start with 2.5 milligrams. We can step it up to 5 milligrams. It's an OD dose. So it's a single dose for 5 days. And we start it on day 1 of the cycle. And we start it on day 1 or day 2 of the cycle, right? Okay, let's see the next question now. At what size of the follicle the following procedure is performed? Now, first thing I would like to ask you is, before telling the size of the follicle at which you will perform this, can you tell me what is the procedure which you are seeing in the picture? What is the picture you are seeing here? What is the image showing you? So this is, so yes, Paritosh has the answer of D. What is this image? What is this procedure? So this is nothing but TVS guided oocyte pickup or ovum pickup. TVS guided oocyte pickup. Right, so it's a TVS guided oocyte pickup, which we do for both IVF as well as your ICSI. So any ART techniques where you want to take the oocytes outside, you have to do this, right? Okay, so I have different answers. Manibala going for B, Paritosh going for D. Right, dominant follicle size, I'm definitely sure that we all know that dominant follicle size is 20 mm. That's the reason why I'm seeing you students answering for B and D. Very good, Sanket. The answer here is C, 16 to 18 mm. The answer here is 16 to 18 mm, 16 to 18 mm, okay? You're all 100% correct that the dominant follicle size is 20 mm, but the pickup we don't do at 20 mm, we take it prior to that only, which at the size of 16 to 18 mm itself, we pick up the oocytes, okay? So we do the oocyte pickup at the size of 16 to 18 mm, right? Clear, guys? Yes, so answer is सी. वेरी गुड श्वेता. सो नाउ वन मोर थिंग आई वुड लाइक टू टेल यू इज व्हाट इज द मोस्ट डेंजरस साइड इफेक्ट व्हेन यू आर डूइंग ओसाइड पिकअप. द मोस्ट डेंजरस साइड इफेक्ट व्हेन यू आर डूइंग द ओसाइड पिकअप इज यू कैन पंक्चर द internal iliac artery. You can puncture the internal iliac artery. That's the most dangerous side effects of the TVS guided oocyte pickup. Okay. Right. I just forgot the image for this. Okay. This surgery is done for which symptom in the woman? So what is this surgery and which symptom do you do this? So this is so I have I have students getting different answers A and B. Can you tell me what is the surgery? What is the surgery? Very good, Dinesh. This is nothing but transobturator tape. Transobturator tape. This is TOT, tension-free transobturator tape. It's a tension-free sling. And this is the surgery of choice for your stress urinary incontinence. This is the surgery of choice for not urge incontinence. It is the surgery of choice for stress urinary incontinence. Okay. So this, we mainly have two tapes, transobturator tape and transvaginal tape. Transobturator tape is more superior compared to transvaginal tape. Transobturator tape is the surgery of choice for stress urinary incontinence. Earlier, what was the surgery of choice is your Birch colpo suspension. But now the surgery of choice is transobturator tape. Earlier it was Birch colpo suspension, but now the surgery of choice is transobturator tape. Okay. So basically, this is a mesh. Whatever you are seeing here. So this is a mesh. So this mesh will go below the urethra and it undergoes fibrosis. So whenever she has the urethral hypermobility and the urethra tries to come down, this will support the urethra and prevents it by coming down, right? So this is done in stress urinary incontinence. Birch was the previous, earlier Birch colpo suspension, but now the surgery of choice is transobturator tape. So let's see the next question. Right, very beautiful. I've seen many students asking me this, such questions getting difficult. So I want you to answer me, what is the diagnosis which you made from this image? I'll give you options here. So this is a USG image. So what is the diagnosis which you made by this image? So I have options, hydrosalpinx, benign ovarian cyst, complex ovarian cyst, Asherman syndrome. So what is the diagnosis which you made from this image? From this image. So this is a USG image. So what is the diagnosis which you are making from this image? Hydrosalpinx, benign ovarian cyst, complex ovarian cyst, or Asherman syndrome? So what you're seeing here, is it a uterus or ovary or fallopian tube? First of all and foremost, I want you to answer that. Okay. So I see here different answers again, A, B, C, D, D, okay. First and foremost, I have to differentiate whether it is a uterus or whether it's an ovary or whether it's a fallopian tube. Basically, the ovary and the fallopian tube will look similar. So they'll have single lining. The lining will be same. But uterus will be different because uterus may you will be able to see myometrium and endometrium. In uterus, you will normally be able to see endometrium and myometrium. So this is not uterus. This is basically the ovary where you're seeing the single lining outside covering. Now it is not fallopian tube also because the hydrosalpinx or the pyosalpinx, the septations which will you see will be incomplete. Here, this you're seeing it's a multiseptated. This is the septations which you're having and they're complete septations. The septum is complete, completely filling in the ovary, right? And these are the multilocules which you're seeing here. And you're also having a solid area. This is the solid area which we are seeing here. So when you see the septations complete and solid area, this is nothing but a complex ovarian cyst. This is complex ovarian cyst. Okay. So the answer here is complex ovarian cyst. So very good, Ketki. It is complex ovarian cyst. Any doubt, guys? You have any doubt in this image? This is a complex ovarian cyst. Now I'll also show you the image of hydrosalpinx. Let's see the next image. So again, so please remember, whenever you're having no myometrium and endometrium, so that will be the your ovary or the fallopian tube, and you can also identify by the question. So here also you're seeing the cyst. There's a cyst, but how are the septations here? The septations are incomplete. They're not here. It is incomplete. Stopping here, right? So these are the incomplete septations which you're seeing. Incomplete septations are seen in hydrosalpinx. So how do I differentiate between ovarian cyst and the hydrosalpinx is in hydrosalpinx, we mainly see incomplete septations. That's very, very important. And that is called as cogwheel appearance. That's called cogwheel appearance. And another important thing is that the shape of the mass will be sausage shaped. It will be sausage shaped. Your hydrosalpinx or pyosalpinx, the fallopian tube mass will look like sausage shaped. So this is one more very important. So if you get a question on the ovarian cyst or hydrosalpinx, please remember hydrosalpinx will have incomplete septations, which we call it as cogwheel appearance, and they'll have sausage shaped appearance. So going back, this is a complex ovarian cyst. So we could make out the diagnosis. It's a complex ovarian cyst. Now I'll give you next option or case scenario and I want you to answer here. So what is the next step I'm asking here? So the next step. So you have a 52-year-old woman coming to you with 4 centimeters ovarian mass as seen in the USG. What is the next step? What do you want to do as the next step? I'll give you options also here. So the options are A, perform cystectomy, B, CA125, okay, C, hysterectomy. Very good. I'm very much impressed by Sirisha. Excellent, Sirisha. So whenever you see any postmenopausal or perimenopausal woman coming to you with an ovarian mass, the first and foremost which you're supposed to do is CA125. So no doubt, the first thing which you're supposed to do in this is CA125. Please remember, this is also very important. Any ovarian mass in elderly women, that is premenopausal and postmenopausal women, the first thing which you're supposed to do is CA125. So we are supposed to do the CA125. Excellent. Very good. Yes, very good, Paritosh. So because of the age, we have to go for CA125 because this is the age where you are going to commonly see the serous cystadenoma or serous cystadenocarcinoma, right? What is the cutoff of CA125? What is the cutoff of CA125? Where you have to consider it as abnormal. What is the cutoff of CA 125 to consider it as abnormal? So the cutoff for CA 125 is 35 international units. 35 international units. If you have it more than 35 international units, irrespective of the size, you have to go for a surgery. Irrespective of size. So when it is more than 35 international units, irrespective of size, we are supposed to go for surgery. Very good, Bhav sir. It is 35. Okay, what you people are telling, the 200 is for RMI index, right? So that is completely different scenario. That is for the referral. But only CA 125 level, if you see, then it is 35 international units. So if it is more than 35 international units, irrespective of the size, you have to go for surgery, right? Okay, so let's see the next question now. A patient presents at 28 weeks with pain abdomen and USG pain abdomen since 3 hours associated with decreased fetal movements. USG showing the following. FHR readings shows 90 beats per minute. What is the management? So what is the diagnosis which you are making from the image? So you have the labeling here, you have the placenta and the retroplacental hemorrhage. So what is this diagnosis which you are making here? Yes. So I have all of you answering for C, except Rajesh. C. Right, the diagnosis abruption, 100%. The diagnosis is abruption. Very good. So this is an abruptio placentae. Very good. Right. Now I have answers here going for C, A, B, and I want you to see abruptio placentae. We follow something called as Pritchard rule. I definitely understand one point why you go for C, that is patient's gestational age is 28 weeks. So for lung maturity, steroids are required. I understand. But still the answer is not C. Why? Because abruption may we follow Pritchard rule. And what is the Pritchard rule? It is immediate termination irrespective of the gestational age. Whenever you have abruption, you don't wait and watch. It's immediate termination and hematocrit should be maintained more than 30% and urine output should be maintained more than 30 ml per hour. Right? So now in our patient, we have, she's 28 weeks with pain abdomen since 3 hours and decreased fetal movement and USG showing FHR recording to 90 beats per minute. So there's a definite bradycardia or the fetal distress. So when you have fetal distress and when you have abruption, what will be the management? Very good. I see now all of you answering correct. Yes. So it is very good. Excellent, Rajesh. You are correct. It is immediate cesarean section. Very good. So the answer here is immediate cesarean section. Okay. Clear, guys? No steroids for lung maturity because in abruption we cannot wait and watch or we cannot wait time for the steroids. Here you have to be as quick as possible, otherwise we are going to lose the baby, right? Okay, so I'll just next tell you about the quickly about the management. So whenever we have abruption, first, we have to see the fetal status. Mommy, sound reduced. If fetus is dead, then we can go for vaginal delivery. But before that, we have to see the maternal status. If maternal is having DIC, correct DIC, and then you go for induction of labor, right? IOL is induction of labor. If fetal distress is present, then you have to go for directly LSCS. But if there is no fetal distress, then you have to try for vaginal delivery. No fetal distress, then you have to go for vaginal delivery. That is again induction of labor. Right? So this is about the abruption management. How do we do the abruption management depending on the fetal status as well as maternal status? So in the above case, we had baby being alive but fetal distress. So that's why we have gone for LSCS. Right. Thank you, Bhav sir. Right. Let's see the next question now. What does the image show? This is a straight cut question, but a previously many times repeated question. So I want you to answer correct, all of you answering correct. So what does the image show? Intrauterine death, congenital heart defect, congenital diaphragmatic hernia, infanticide. Very good. I see all of you answering correct. Bhushan, Nabarun, Kulvant, Chaitanya. Very good. Excellent. So this is nothing but intrauterine death. What is this sign? Very good, Chaitanya. It's nothing but Spalding sign. So this is again a straight cut question, but yes, many times repeated question. So we should be aware with it. This is nothing but Spalding sign. So Spalding sign is the overlapping of the fetal skull bones, overlapping of the fetal skull bones. So I'll here quickly ask you some points about the intrauterine death. What is the first sign in the intrauterine death? What is the first sign in intrauterine death? Very good, excellent. That's the overlapping of Spalding. What is the first sign in intrauterine death? The first sign in intrauterine death is Robert's sign. So Robert's sign is gas seen in. Yes, Robert's sign is the first sign, that is gas seen in the big vessels of the fetus. That's mainly the aorta, right? This will be seen within 12 hours. This sign will be seen within 12 hours. Next we have the Spalding sign. Spalding sign is the overlapping of the skull bones, which we see it in the by 1 week. And the last one is the ball sign. The last one is the ball sign. When do we see ball sign? Ball sign is the last sign to be seen, where you will see hyperflexion or the cribbling of the ribs, hyperflexion of the spine of the fetus. So this is the last one to see, ball sign, right? So that's about the IUD, and whatever image which we have seen here, there was the Spalding sign. Very good, Niranjan, Srinidhi, excellent. So let's go to the next question now. Identify the image. I have received some queries about such images. Again, very, very important whenever you are having image-based questions. Placenta image is many times mandatory, either placenta previa or velamentous or something like this. So what is this? Circummarginate, circumvallate, battle door, velamentous. Yes, I see C, A, B. So I have all the options answers here. I see some students going with very good, Niranjan, Paritosh, excellent. So the answer here is, I can see some students answering for B. So the answer here is B, circumvallate. It is circumvallate. So this is circumvallate. Okay, now I definitely know you have a confusion between option A and C, but answer is B, that is circumvallate. Now let me tell you what are the points which are telling me that it is neither A nor C, but it is B. Number one, it's not, it looks like as if the umbilical cord is coming from the margin, but whenever you have to call it as it is coming from the margin, the it should be within 2 centimeters from the peripheral margin. So this is beyond 2 centimeters from peripheral margin. So let's rule out battledore. This is not marginal placenta previa. This is circumvallate. Now what is favoring the circumvallate is you are having central depression. There's a central depression. You can see the central depression. More than central depression, what is very important for me to diagnose the circumvallate is, can you see there is double fold thickness of the amnion and chorion. The chorion has folded here and I can make out the thickness. I can make out that folding and it is double fold. That's why it is thick here. So that is how you make it out, right? Very good, Rajesh. So again, you have answered it correct. So this is circumvallate. Clear, guys? Whenever you have double fold thickness at the margin, see, it should be thick. If you're seeing a thick margin covering the placenta, then it is circumvallate. Right, this is circumvallate. Now I will show you what is circummarginate. This is circummarginate. Circummarginate will have peripheral margin. This is also having a cover of chorion and amnion, but it is a single fold. It's a single fold. So the covering or the edge which you see here will not be thick. It will be thin. Can you make out the difference? The covering which you're seeing here will be thin. Right? See the previous image. How thick? This is double fold of amnion and chorion. So that's why it is thick. As it's double fold, it is thick. As it is single fold, this is thin. And one more very important, this will be mainly peripherally located, whereas this will present to you as with central depression. This will present to you with central depression. Now, how do I remember marginate? The name itself is marginate, so it has peripheral margin. It has peripheral margin, right? So it is mainly by the thickening. Very good, Shreya, that's all. So clear, guys, are you clear with the images of circumvallate and circummarginate? I hope now you'll not have a confusion. Battledore may you'll not have any coverings. See, you're seeing the amnion and chorion covering here. In battledore, you'll not have amnion and chorion covering. Only thing in battledore, you'll see the placental, the umbilical cord being attached to the margin, that is within 2 centimeters from the margin, within 2 centimeters from the peripheral margin, right? Right, let's go to the next question now. Yes, so this is the AIIMS question, right? The following instrument is used in which operation? So in the previous question, I have a query from Dinesh. What do we do in the other option? The other option which was left out was velamentous. Velamentous mein the cord is attached to the membranes. So that completely looks different. Okay, so it is attached to the membranes and I can see the fetal vessels still traversing through the membranes. Okay, Dinesh? Right. So yes, what is the following instrument and which operation do you use this? This was asked as an image-based question in November AIIMS 2019. Very good, excellent. So this is Doyne's retractor and this Doyne's retractor is used for cesarean section. So that is very, very important for us to know that this is a Doyne's retractor and Doyne's retractor. See, some basic instruments we cannot afford to lose mark. So this is a Doyne's retractor and this is used in cesarean section. And what is the function of this Doyne's retractor? It is to retract the bladder. It is to retract the bladder. This is Doyen's. So what we do here is we separate the uterovesicle fold. We separate the uterovesicle fold. So in cesarean section, once you open the abdomen and then you make a loop, when you make a small nick in the loose uterovesicle fold, so then the bladder will be separated from the lower uterine segment. And then we take the incision on the lower uterine segment. So this is the Doyne's retractor which we use for cesarean section to retract the bladder. No confusion. This is very important. Yes, very good, Rajesh. Right. So let's see, go to the next question now. Where do we use the following image? zone 1, zone 2, zone 3. Pretty simple question, but still very important. You have to write for me what is the answer here and what is this chart called as? Very good, excellent. The answer here is RH isoionization. So whatever you're seeing is the RH isoionization. Excellent, Gautam. So it is the name is the Lilly's chart. It's the Lilly's chart. Very good. So this was pretty simple, right? Now I'll ask you one more question for you to answer. What is the another chart which we can use in RH isoionization? What is the alternative chart to Lilly's chart which we use at a very early gestational age? This is Lilly's chart. What is an alternative to Lilly's chart? Yes, Shabana, Suruchi, Karthik, Divya. What is the alternative to Lilly's chart which we have for RH isoionization? Excellent, Bhushan. Pretty impressed. 100. Very good. Excellent. I'm very happy with Bhushan. So the alternative chart which we have with the RH isoionization is the Queenan's chart. In Lilly's chart, you have three zones, whereas in Queenan's chart, you have four zones, and you can use it from pretty early gestational age itself. That is, we can use it by 18 weeks itself. Right. Very good. That's the alternative is Queenan's chart. Very good, Shabana. So now I'll have one more question asked here. What do you do when plotting comes in zone 1? Zone 1. Very good. Zone 1, it is repeat amnio after 4 weeks. Zone 1 is repeat amnio after 4 weeks. Zone 1 suggests mild anemia and you can repeat the amniocentesis after 4 weeks. Zone 2 suggests moderate anemia. And when do you repeat in amniocentesis in zone 2? Zone 2 repeat amnio after 1 week. Repeat after 1 week. Whereas zone 3 indicates severe anemia and this requires intrauterine blood transfusion. Intrauterine blood transfusion. And deliver by 34 weeks. And deliver by 34 weeks. Right? Okay, so let's see the next question now. That's the last question which I have for today. What is the management when partogram lies in amber colored zone? So we also have a simplified color coded partogram, the WHO modified partogram itself, which is a color coded. So whenever your partogram lies in the amber colored zone, what is the management? So this is the amber colored zone. So what will be the management when it lies in the amber colored zone? C, refer to higher center. Okay, very good. Shweta. Excellent. So I see majority of you are answering. Shweta and Shreya are correct. So it is referred to the higher center. So if you observe, you have three zones in the color coded. One is green zone. See, basically, it is your normal partogram itself. That is a modified, so it's starting from 4 centimeters. That is nothing but modified WHO partogram. Except that this is color coded. You'll have three colors here, green color, amber colored, and red color. So basically, it is green colored, amber colored, and red color, right? And whatever this junction between green and amber colored, this is nothing but alert line. 4 hours apart from the alert line, we have the action line, right? So the same story again here. When partogram is before alert line, that is in the green zone, you have to just wait and watch. That's pretty normal. Our partogram is going pretty normal, right? When partogram is between alert line and action line, when partogram is between alert line and action line, that is amber colored zone, that means that it has crossed the alert line. So what do you do when it crosses the alert line? You have to refer to the higher center and we have to get alerted. When it crosses the action line, that is the time where you have to take the intervention as required. So when do we take intervention? Whenever it is in zone red, you have to take the intervention. But now in the question, I have asked you for amber colored. So what will be the answer? It will not be LSES. It will not be intervention. So it will be referred to higher center, neither D, wait and watch. So answer here is C, right? Right. So clear, guys. So this is some of the images which I wanted to speak about. And I think I've crossed my time also. So I'll take a leave and I'll be again coming back soon with another YouTube live session. And for more videos of mine, you can follow me in the Unacademy app. Thank you, guys. Any doubts before I end the session? Any doubts you'd like to ask me? I hope this was helpful for all of you as an image-based questions. So next session, I'll be coming up with some more important questions which might come for us in the exam, and we make sure that it is going to help us. Thank you. Thank you, Bhavsar, Sirisha, Nabarun. Thank you. Thanks a lot.